Welcome to the 16th edition of the Jaipur Literature Festival, protected by Dettol, Banega, Swasth India, at the Dalbar Hall. We are delighted to introduce The Last Heroes, a conversation between P. Sainath, introduced by Kavita Srivastava. Journalist P. Sainath's recent book, The Last Heroes, Foot Soldiers of Indian Freedom, introduces us to the ordinary men, women, and children who form the foundation of the independence movement. His book delves into the grassroots of the movement while also examining the struggle for freedom well after 1947. This session will be held in conversation with Kavita Srivastava. I'm delighted to introduce our first guest. Palagummi Sainath is the founder and editor of the People's Archive of Rural India. A journalist and reporter for over four decades, he has covered rural India for over 30 years. His new book, The Last Heroes, Foot Soldiers of Indian Freedom, is about the last fighters in India's struggle for independence. Introducing him is Kavita Srivastava, a human rights worker and feminist associated with several people's campaigns and movements, including the right to food, work, and information. She is a part of the collective that believes that another world is possible and is extremely concerned about the state of Indian democracy. She is also an anti-nuclear and peace activist.
Good afternoon, everybody. So let's welcome our friend P. Sainath, somebody who has been visiting Jaipur and Rajasthan regularly. He has chased his stories in these parts of the country, you know, the hundreds and hundreds of stories that he's done. Many of them come from here, and it's like coming back home. So a big hand to Sainath. Friends, it's really my privilege to introduce a very dear friend of 2.5 decades. So let me quickly go over why he matters to us in India when we are celebrating our 75th independence. Sainath is extremely important, as he called himself an auditor of the government, a journalist who's an auditor of the government. So that's the kind of journalist I'm introducing you. He was the former rural affairs editor of The Hindu. He's the winner of the Fukuoka Grand Prize, Japan's top international award. And a winner, the first Indian actually to win the 2007 Raman Magsaysay Award, journalist, huh? Mind you. And we all know it, what a respected prize for journalism, literature, creative communication it is. As told by the earlier speaker, he's been 40 years into reporting, and he's like, you know, our conscience. He's the nation's conscience. And he's identified himself as a rural reporter for the last 3.5 decades. Writing about inequality, deprivation, poverty, hunger, migration, misery, and distress in some of the most leading newspapers of the country. He did not only get the Magsaysay Award, but he was a winner of the Amnesty International Global Human Rights Journalism. And the organization I belong to the PUCL, confirmed on him in 1994, the PUCL Human Rights Journalism Award. And let me tell you, 50 such awards, I won't go through that list, but I can hand it over to any of you. He refused India's highest civilian award, the Padma Award. He was being conferred the Padma Bhushan. He refused it because journalists are not meant to receive awards from governments. They're supposed to critique. I hope journalists are listening to this. For exemplary work, he won the World Media Summit Global Award for excellence in public welfare. His writings actually translate into public policy, and therefore this. And there are many others. He's, of course, he was conferred a D.Litt by the University of Alberta in Edmonton, and he teaches in several universities, including McGraw and the universities at Nova Scotia in Canada and others. Two of his documentary films, Nero's Guest and A Tribe of His Own, were picked up and received more than 20 awards across the globe. His writings, and this is just... The book, this is one of his writings, the latest, but before that, he has covered culture, people, livelihood, their struggles of survival, and of course, what astounded us all was the series on the devastation of Indian farmers, the anti-farming policies resulted in suicides by several thousands. And he brought out the agrarian, that agrarian crisis. And of course, it actually helped set the agenda for investigative rural reporting for the country. There was another story for which he came to Rajasthan, and that was a nationwide project on Dalits. And 40 such reports were written, and he went to he traveled around Rajasthan in the worst districts of Bharatpur and Dholpur, and also wrote from there on the atrocities against Dalits. And this present book, of course, this is his second book, which is The Last Heroes, The Foot Soldiers of Indian Freedom. But before that, I mean, a book which is still like going continuously into reprint is Everybody Loves a Good Drought. It's in its 50th printing, in which Sainath traveled 1 lakh kilometers across the country, you know, using all kinds of transport. And of course, this was one of the best reporting volumes of the 20th century, along with Gabriel Garcia Marquez, John Reed, and others. And it's a book where in over 100 universities, this book ended up in, and overseas, and it's been translated into many, many, many languages. And the royalty from this goes towards funding 2-3 prizes for rural reporting. I've told you about the latest films, the 2 films that he made, which got awards. But Sainath is a photographer. He takes photographs of everything that when he travels, he writes. And one of his most famous exhibitions, which also came to Jaipur, was Visible Work, Invisible Women, Women and Work in Rural India. Of course, the work that he loves is teaching and training. He's been a teacher for 35 years, teaching at various educational institutions. And of course, he's got a permanent chair, the chair for Professor in Rural India, which is the first ThoughtWorks chair at the Asian College of Journalism in Chennai, which he's been teaching since 2001. He teaches at the Sophia Polytechnic, Mumbai for over 20 years, and even here, many of his students have come who met us outside, and of course, across the world in Columbia, Harvard, etc., he has been teaching. He trains journalists regularly, journalists from the poorest parts of India, and so that some of the finest, we know some of the finest reporting comes from those areas, and many of our reporters build on that kind of reporting, and remembering that Sainath spends a lot of time training such journalists. And of course, PARI, this is his latest project of love since 2014. It's the only journalistic website that appears in 14 languages. Can you believe it? 14 languages. It's a journal, it's an archive which covers entire rural India, 833 million people living in distinct societies. Sainath tells us there are more than 700 spoken languages. And therefore, that diversity of labor, livelihood, languages, arts, craft, through video, through multimedia, they have tried to offer it through PARI. And lots of young people, teachers, the people give their independent time, their voluntary time also to PARI and research for it. What is the impact? So that's the last part about Sainath. Sainath's work, his reports on deaths of farmers, hunger, migration, pushed the government of India and state governments to build policies like farm loan waiver, farmers crisis package, including the development of the famous NREGA, during the 2008-09, when he served as a member of the expert group constituted by the Ministry of Rural Development. He helped them formulate the methodology for the BPL, which was slightly different from the earlier ones. Sainath's investigative reportings of rural India brought Dr. Manmohan Singh to journey to some parts that Sainath had written about and go and meet those farmers and build some policy related to it, including in Maharashtra, the National Farmers Commission that came up decided to address some of the issues. So friends, there is also a film on Sainath, A Tribe of His Own, The Journalism of P. Sainath. If some of you are interested, you could see it. And of course, Nero's Guest, which is the work of Sainath and Inequality made by Deepa Dhanraj, is really worth seeing. I close here, friends, and leave you by intermittent questions that I'll ask of Sainath, but it's basically going to be Sainath and you. And before I take my seat and Sainath comes to the podium, I'm going to ask the first question of Sainath. How come, Sainath, who has been writing on distress, migration, hunger, farmer suicide, Dalit atrocities, how come he writes a book like this, which is today's discussion topic, The Last Heroes, Foot Soldiers of Indian Freedom. Mark the words, freedom, not independence, freedom. So my first question from my side and on behalf of all, Sainath, why did you write this book, which was just released a month ago in Delhi, in the 75th year of Indian independence? How come? While the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav was being, celebrated all over. How come this book arrives?
Thank you, Kavita. Thanks very much. Why did I write this book? First, I wrote this book for the people in it. They have a right to have their stories told. Their stories matter. These are the people who were the frontline troops, the ordinary foot soldiers of freedom. I wrote the book for the people in it. Their stories need to be told. And we need their stories in order to better shape our own, in order to better sculpt our own. We need their stories. The second thing, it's written for young people who have been robbed of their history completely. Yeah. The third, I'll explain that in the 75 years of Indian independence, the government of India has put up a website. I believe the first tranche of the celebrations was 110 crores. Anyway, the website is called Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. And this website, it says 75 years of Indian independence, but seems to be pushing the freedom struggle backwards to Alauddin Khilji. Okay? Yeah. Well, you know who the enemy is, right? So, Lachit Borphukan, who very great Assamese warrior, very fine general, has suddenly come into 75 years of independence celebration, though he lived 150 years before British colonialism. We are moving backwards so that a particular political force can invent a role for itself in the freedom struggle, because they had none in the struggle against the British Empire. Okay? That's one. Yeah. Can we raise this? Yeah. So that one can invent oneself a history in freedom struggle. And it's unfortunate that that's the only force that has no such history. I want to tell all the many young faces I see here, I want you to go back. Talk to your grandparents, and some of you are young enough looking to have great grandparents alive. You will find what a movement that was. You will find that every family has a story of the freedom struggle. Every Indian family has a story of the freedom struggle, because that's how widespread it was. That's how huge and all encompassing it was. It was not the gift of a few returning Oxbridge elites and Barrett laws and whatever. They played a great role. They were leaders, but nothing in the first line of the introduction quotes Gandhi saying, you know, great men seem to be the cause of revolutions in the world. In truth, the people themselves are the cause. Way back in 2014, when being congratulated and feted in London for his role in South Africa, Gandhi said, it wasn't me, it was the indentured laborers who fought and won. And he cites moving stories, particularly one from the Punjab of Hathi Singh, a 75-year-old freed indentured laborer who comes back to join Gandhi's fight in South Africa, shares a cell with Gandhi, dies. Gandhi is so angry with Hathi Singh, he says, you know, the man was freed. He said, Hathi Singh, how could you come back? Hathi Singh says, how could I not when my people are struggling for freedom? And the people in this, the what is so offensive in the robbing of history, the media are complicit in this. In this 1 year, 75th year of Indian independence, have you seen one full-length program, one series of articles or a magazine cover story on what British colonialism did to this country? Not a word or a paragraph about it in the Amrit, Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav website. Not a word about British colonialism. Not a word about an empire. The latest research, you can read this beautiful paper on capitalism and global poverty in World Development Report. An empire in 40 years between 1880 and 1920 accounted, you know how we are all having a debate over excess deaths under COVID? The rest of the country tells, rest of the world tells us we lost more than 4 million people. The government of India says 4,86,000, and everything else is a conspiracy. You know, the 188 other nations of the world have no time for anything else except conspiracies against India. Yeah. You know what the excess deaths under colonialism were 40 years, 1880 to 1920? 165 million. Yeah, that's what demographers are showing us now. 165 million. And no mention of nothing of what the British did to India. Nothing about what, about the 31 famines that India saw. We never saw one after you got these guys out of your country. 31 famines, mostly policy driven, including the last Bengal famine, where more than 4 million human beings starved to death. Yeah. The only great thing that the famine gave us was the young Amartya Sen, who at the age of 11 watched people coming in to the city and dying on the streets, and that inspired him to work for the rest of his career on subjects of hunger and famine. Yeah. So Nothing about these 31 famines. Nothing about an empire whose Governor General Warren Hastings, after the Great Bengal Famine of 1776, wrote to the East India Company Governing Board, notwithstanding the death of so many millions in Purnia, notwithstanding the fact that fully a third of the population has been decimated, we have still managed to raise the rents. These are the sort of, nothing about British colonialism, which preceded Nazis by 60 years in inventing eugenics by passing the 1871 Criminal Tribes Act in this country, whereby you said that 200 tribes, Indian tribes, were genetically criminal. If you were born in them, you're a criminal. And of course, what do we do with that? We repeal the act in 1952 and continue with the discrimination, replacing it with something sweetly called Habitual Offenders Act. Yeah, and it's still the same Pardis, Parayas, yeah, who are pulled up anytime there is a crime in a region. It's those same tribal people who are pulled up and humiliated, who can't get a job anywhere because of the stigma that still continues. None of this is told to our young generation, and that's why I wrote this book. You have nothing about, and still, with all these things, Kavita, you go and lower your flag to mourn the death of the symbol of that imperial oppression, Queen Elizabeth. I don't care what she was as an individual. She symbolized that imperial power that saw 168 million excess deaths in this country. What's more, you shamelessly humiliate your flag. A flag is not a piece of cloth with patches of color daubed onto it. It has a history. It's an expression of a people's aspiration. It's your national aspiration. What did we do? The rule, the law about the flag in your country, and your media hardly told you this, is that it can only be made of khadi. Instead of which, you changed the flag code, allowed people to make it of polyester, and you know who's got plenty of that. Yeah? Thousands of khadi weavers across this country live for two occasions in the year, Republic Day and Independence Day, when they get to make some income, some earning, and they do with pride and dignity because they're making the national flag. Not a single one of them got a single order. They went bankrupt while polyester flags proliferated across the country. Here is a generation robbed of its history, and I'm afraid your generation and mine were the robbers. You know, that's why I needed to write this book.
Thank you so much, Sainath. The title of your book, The Last Heroes, Foot Soldiers of Indian Freedom, I think is a very, very contemporary idea. I mean, it continues to be a contemporary book. It's not about 75 years ago. Freedom is something that all your heroes in the book talk about. They distinguish independence from freedom. And today, if there's an onslaught on something, that's freedom. Yeah. How do you look at it, and how would you like to reflect on it today?
The first line of this book on a separate page has this incredible man, Captain Bhau, Ramchandra Sripati Lad. In 1943, when the British were weak, backs to the wall in Europe, a lot of colonies rebelled, rose in uprisings against the British. 3-4 parts of India declared secession. One of them was Satara. The old Satara included Sangli and was the Tufan Sena sprang up, an underground army under the Prati Sarkar of Nana Patil, the provisional government of Satara. And they took control of 600 villages and only dissolved the provisional government when Gandhi appealed in 1946, independence is coming, now it's time for everybody to return to the table. Captain Bhau says in one line, and he said it at age 100, at age 99 when I did the last interview with him, he said, "We fought for freedom and independence. We achieved independence." That was the line. Every one of the people in this book tell you about that difference between independence and freedom. Independence was the project of independence was to throw out the colonial ruler. Freedom was and is, every one of them tells you, a much larger project that remains unfinished. And the beauty of it is, half a dozen of them are not only alive between 98 and 104, they're still bloody active. N. Sankaraya, R. Nallakkannu, still make speeches, still get onto platforms and make speeches about freedom. Yeah? Because they say it's not been realized. Yeah? But there is a beautiful continuity, and it's there in our young people whom this book is for. Tell me, when the anti-CAA agitations came up, what were those young 17 and 18 and 19-year-olds reading out? Justice for all, social, economic, political, liberty, equality, fraternity. They were reading from the Constitution of India, the preamble. And though, as I keep telling those young students of that age who are my students, you know, there are some other interesting pages as well in the Constitution. But they were reading, when they were reading that, they were connecting directly with the freedom struggle. They were connecting directly with the freedom struggle because your Constitution is the quintessence, it is the essence, of the idealism and the ideals of the freedom struggle. They speak of the need to defend the Constitution of India because the threat to freedom is so great. There are a couple of people in the book who say that, you know, that this was our fight. And every one of them makes it clear that it wasn't just about throwing out the colonial ruler. Also, to look at the spectrum of people who fought, the sheer diversity of the people who fought in this.
Can you tell us a little about this amazing diversity, the 13 stories is from all over India, and the women, farmers, Dalits, can you just share that diversity with us?
One, women, like in so many other things, are erased in your freedom struggle. Yeah. Like they're erased in farm suicide data, in farm work data, they're erased. But of course, the names you know were from the elite or super elite. Okay, the Raja Rani Log or Sarojini Naidu, all very, very eminent people from the elite. But women fought in more ways than you can imagine. More ways than the men did. For me, one of the most fascinating characters I have ever met in my life is Babani Mahato, aged 104 when I met her. And she is still, the whole day of the interview, she protested that she had nothing to do with the freedom struggle. And I was really getting disappointed and disheartened because I had been told otherwise. Then she kept saying, my husband, Baidyanath, he was a freedom fighter. He went to jail 13 months. You know, we've got this idea that a freedom fighter is someone who went to jail. Anyway, so she said, I said in disappointment, it must have been hard. She said, I cooked, I looked after the family, I grew the food, I did the cooking. I was looking after a family of 25 plus more people whom he would bring. Then I said, it must have been hard on you when your husband went to prison for 13 months. She said, no, actually it was much worse when he came back. Because I said, why? I was stunned. She said, because he brought even more people for me to feed. It turned out that at the height of the Bengal famine, which is not 1943, but 1942, Babani Mahato was growing food at the height of the famine and cooking for and feeding 20 to 25 underground revolutionaries hiding in the forests of Purulia, West Bengal. If that is not participation in the freedom struggle, I don't know what the hell is. And I think it's far greater participation than what her husband did by going to jail for 13 months in Bagalpur. Yeah. So this book has cooks, couriers, homemakers, farmers, laborers, the salt of the earth, carpenters, Malis, in the village of Panimura, for instance, in Odisha. Which village produced the largest number of recognized freedom fighters with 32 Tamapatras? But what a sense of fun, what a sense of exuberance. It is a great disappointment to me that I could not bring here, because of the weather, a Rajasthani freedom fighter. I tell you, you guys should be proud of him, those of you who are from Rajasthan. Shobha Ram Geherwar of Ajmer, just turning 98, and he's the infant in the book. He's the infant in the book.
He's the youngest.
Youngest, yeah. And here's a guy, self-proclaimed Gandhian, who was making bombs for 11 years and justified it by telling me, maine dono nadiya mein gaya, Gandhivad aur Krantivad. Then he demanded that it was Ambedkar Jayanti, it was Kavita who found him for me, and I'm eternally grateful for that. Yeah. And Kavita was also the translator in his language, in, you know, the way he spoke in Hindi and everything else. So he said, you know, that he noticed we had an SUV. He said, I want to garland Ambedkar in the Ajmer main market. So we said, of course. Quaking because of the stupid present day debates over this, quaking, I asked him a question after he garlanded Ambedkar. How does someone like you, a self-declared Gandhian, choose between Gandhi and Ambedkar? He got mad. He said, you choose, why should I choose? He said, those principles of the Mahatma which I admire and respect, I follow those. Those principles of Baba Saheb which I admire and follow, admire and respect, I follow those. What he was telling us was, do not pigeonhole us. The people of that generation were, you know, open to many influences except one. None of them ever had that one force influencing them. But these were the kind of people. Shobha Ram, as a child of 5, came into the freedom struggle because he met and escorted Chandrasekhar Azad, who was killed 4 weeks later. And here's a guy, he's a cantankerous old man, living, hanging on to life. Though he's in great shape, he walks faster than I do. But obviously his family would be worried about his coming out. When we spoke, it was, Jaipur was recording 4 degrees and 5 degrees in the morning. Here is a man who is living to protect the freedom fighters' bhavan in Ajmer. He says, look around this market. All the bloody real estate sharks are waiting to take this property. And I'm appealing to Chief Minister Ashok Gehlot, and I'm adding my appeal to his. Please, the state should take over this freedom fighters' bhavan and make it state and national property, because the real estate sharks. Now, at 98, the guy continues like this. Yeah? It's amazing. And he speaks with so much humor. Another of these freedom fighters, a renegade landlord, a girl born into a landlord family, which she rebelled against and distributed her land. Mallu Swarajyam. Yeah? Now, this woman, at 11, she was killing Razakars of the Nizams with a slingshot. At 13, she was becoming a leader. At 16, she was the leader of all the armed dalams of the uprising of 1943 to 46 in Telangana, male and female, by which time she was using a rifle. I put Mallu Swarajyam before an audience of 1,500 techies in Hyderabad. And she, as a journalist, sometimes you have to ask the dumb question for the audience, right? So, and techies. So, quaking, I asked her, you know, Swarajyam Garu, you know, you were, slingshot is fine. I've seen hunters use it. Irulas use it. Bondas use it. But is it really an effective weapon in combat? She got mad. 84 years old. She stood up ramrod straight, whipped a slingshot out of her sari pallu and demonstrate it. And I'm going to request the tech team, can you play the 2-minute video of Mallu Swarajam, and you get a taste of what these people were and are. Can you play the Mallu Swarajam video, please?
Did it grow across the hall?
She removed the cricket ball. She said, I don't want to hurt you.
ఆనాడు 4,000 మంది అమరులైన సామాన్యమైనటువంటి రైతులు హరిజన గిరిజన జనం మా కళ్ళ ముందే ప్రాణాలను అర్పించి పోరాడుతూ ఉంటే ఆ పోరాటంలో తుపాకులు అందుకొని రాళ్ళు అందుకొని ఒడిశాలో తీసుకొచ్చిన చూపించడానికి మీకు ఆడవాళ్ళు మగవాళ్ళు ఆ ఫ్యూడలిజానికి వ్యతిరేకంగా ఊరుకు ఊరు ఏకమై గడీల మీద ఇలాంటి ఒడిశాలలో ఒక రాయి ఇందులో బాలుంది బహుశా ఈ బాలు కూడా గట్టిగానే ఉంది మీ దగ్గరికి వస్తే దెబ్బ తాకుతుంది అందుకని ఇది వీళ్ళ పెడుతున్నా నేను దెబ్బ తాకుతుంది దీనిని పట్టుకొని ఇట్లా తిప్పి 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 కొట్టే పోలీసులు
You can stop that video there. At 92, she gave me her last interview. The interviews were done across 2 decades. Yeah. And Mallu Swarajam, and there's a 2-minute interview clip of, these are very long interviews. As I said, this book is written for young people. At the end of every chapter is a QR code. Because a book, you can't see videos, and you can see only 2 photos per story. But yeah, if you go to the website,
like
People's
this.
Archive of Rural India.
QR code. Yeah. And it is seamless. I did try it.
Yeah.
You can just, after every chapter, you can actually go to the website.
Yeah.
And see the visuals, know more about them, see the detailed interviews.
Yeah. So, if you look at that, you'll know the kind, I mean, you'll see their families, videos of... Let me show you one more video and then I think we've really got to race.
Then one last question and...
Shobaram Geherwar, the video below Mallu Swarajam's, can I request the tech team to show...
The next video, please.
And I have asked him also the question about, did the RSS participate in the freedom struggle? See his answer.
हम लोग सप्लाई करते थे बच्चे हाँ बम्बई नहीं आ रहे हैं
सप्लाई
कहाँ नहीं आ रहे हैं कहाँ कहीं छोड़ भी दिया हम जो कहते भाई खुद तुम आओ तो हम लोग पकड़े जाएंगे बड़े आदमी तो मतलब बच्चा जान के छोड़ भी देगा
यही
चंद्रशेखर आजाद और एक और था वो फैक्ट्री देगा तो ले जाके फिर उन्होंने बोली थी और वो चिट्ठियों को भी अब डाक को पहुंचाना बड़ा मायने रखता था तो हमारी टोली बनाई उन्होंने हमें ट्रेनिंग दी कि भाई इस माफिक से आपको ये चिट्ठी फलानी जगह पहुंचानी है बड़ौदा में देनी है डॉक्टर अम्बेडकर को स्वतंत्र थाने में पूछता ही नहीं ना कोई किताब है जो पढ़ पढ़ेगा कि हमने इस आजादी कैसे पुलिस की नहीं करना क्या मालूम ये सब खा गए देश को करोड़ों अभी अभी तो वह नहीं
स्वतंत्र संग्राम में आरएसएस कई
इसमें उंगली भी नहीं कटी
सो
थैंक यू यू कैन स्टॉप दैट वीडियो
दैट्स इट
हिज एग्जैक्ट वर्ड्स वेयर एक उंगली नहीं कटाई
सो साईनाथ कंटिन्यूइंग फ्रॉम हियर डिड दे एवर वांट टू अपोलोजाइज व्हेन दे वर इन जेल और बीइंग अंडरग्राउंड did they ever write letters saying that, you know, spare us?
No, they never.
Because the Mr. Veer Savarkar, whom we also turning into a hero in the 75th year of the freedom struggle, wrote these 12 letters.
Kavita, these very diverse freedom fighters, between them 10-12 languages. Their different cultural backgrounds, their different political backgrounds. I came to conclude that most of them were leftist by political persuasion, Gandhian by moral code, the way they lived. Yeah? And the one thing they had in common, though are so diverse, they never cringed or bowed before the British Empire. They never compromised, they never begged. In fact, they remind me of the Irish version of the sun never sets on the British Empire. My granddad was a freedom fighter who was expelled from Ireland in 1917. He had participated in the Easter uprising and other stuff like that. And the Irish revolutionary version of the sun never sets was, the sun never sets on the British Empire because even God can't trust those bastards in the dark. And he never asked. Unlike the point you're making about Savarkar, please let me tell you one thing very quickly. Mr. Savarkar, in my opinion, was a bona fide revolutionary till 1911. After he's jailed, he goes the other extreme, the full way. Not only is he writing petitions for his release, which is okay, lots of others did. I mean, a few others did. He's begging for a chance to collaborate. He is saying, release me and I will bring millions of misguided youth to the path of British civilization and this kind of stuff. The petitions are available, five of them are available for you in the National Archives. Okay, also published in Noorani's great book on the RSS. So Mr. Savarkar, in 1926, a book appeared, The Life of Barrister Savarkar. The book was extraordinary. I mean, if you look at how it was written, it gives hagiography a bad name. Then in 1942, it was written by Chitragupta, the scribe of Lord Yama. Anyway, in 1986, there are many debates. Who is Chitragupta? Some people said Rajagopalachari wrote it. Now, one thing, I disagreed with Rajaji all my life as a youngster, and I disagreed with his politics, his economics even more so. But you know one thing, the man could write. Yeah, and he would never write such rubbish. Yeah, we grew up on his Mahabharata and Ramayana in English, and he could write. Okay. So finally, Savarkar's brother reveals to the publisher who the Chitragupta was. It was Savarkar himself. I had not known this till that was revealed, and I had to conclude that Mr. Savarkar had a very high opinion of Mr. Savarkar. Yeah. So let's leave him out of this tranche. Yeah.
We should now open up for a few questions. Yeah, please, very quickly. Are mics going around?
Welcome, sir. My question this. Welcome to Jaipur. My question is related to agricultural problems. You have been very vocal about the conditions of farmers and the problems associated with it, more so the extreme disparities between wealth. Yeah. So can you just tell, because this country has been agriculture, this is reducing.
Yeah, we got the point. We got the question. Yes. So you want to know the disparity.
What we are actually creating a solution to the problem that people should not migrate to cities to create more
okay.
standards.
Madam, it's a different conversation, but I will tell you the link between the agrarian crisis and this book.
Take the mic.
Yes. Yeah. All the rebellions against the British came from people defending their land and agriculture. And all came from rural people. You know, we talk about the 1857 sepoy mutiny. There is no sipahi. The British were as murderous with pronunciation as with people. And the so-called sepoy mutiny, the sipahi It did not come from the people of Meerut, Lucknow, the Sipahi who revolted. The Sipahi then, the Jawan today. The Jawan is a Kisan in uniform. And he has to reflect the mood of his village. With all those famines and deaths and their entire clans being wiped out, the soldiers of the army revolted against the East India Company and the British. That was the connection. 1857 was not a sepoy mutiny. It was the greatest agrarian crisis, uprising the world had seen up to that date. Yeah, that's the continuity. Yeah.
So we'll take your question of whether people should not migrate outside the hall. It's different. Yeah.
Yeah.
So can you just take the mic to the person there on the left side? Yeah.
And please ask the question quickly. That, we're running out of time. Yeah.
Some other time. Yeah. Two of you.
We are right now, we were making mockery of RSS and right wings. What was the role of leftist during that time? So for my knowledge, they did not have any contribution to that.
Sorry, could you?
I didn't understand the question.
Yeah, we didn't understand.
Right now, we have been making mockery of Veer Savarkar vis-a-vis RSS. And what was the role of leftist during that period of freedom?
Well, you saw two of them on the videos just now. Malu Swarajam and Shobaram Gherwa. That's my answer. Yes, sir.
Yeah, so please take it to... Just a minute. Yeah. The woman who's wearing black... Yeah. No, wait. Just a minute. She had a hand before. Just wait for me to tell
next,
you
the next
the mic. Question. Please take the mic.
Yeah.
Because there's another person. Two hands. I'm really sorry. Nani, there are two hands.
Okay,
you'll
let's,
get
let's move quickly. Yeah.
Switch on the mic, yeah.
Very quickly. See, when we are talking about the period that you've written about, there you see a whole spectrum of people with an idea and with an ideology which is extremely and naturally progressive. Okay?
Okay.
The same section of people we see today, so there's a whole kind of decades of history in which there's a huge change which has been wrought. Okay. These are the very people today who are not the supporters of freedom, let us say, short. So what do you think is accounts for that?
Okay, firstly, I think your description is far too sweeping. Okay. Yeah, for you to say that all of them are... All the people in this book who are still alive, and eight of them are still active fighting for their causes. They are not the same people fighting for something else. In the meantime, a society and a country and a generation have been robbed of their history. Yeah, and that's why I wrote this book, to exactly answer that question.
After this. Yeah. We have one more question.
Yeah.
Please go.
Sainath, I just want to say this is the age of misinformation. It's the age of misinformation and a whole machinery changing stories about our past continuously. The people that you talked about, I'm an avid reader of the freedom struggle and I didn't know anything about any of them. I just want to know, is there a plan to translate this book in all the Indian languages?
Marathi is out on January 30th. There are three people from Maharashtra, Rekha, your own state. There are three people from that state in the book, Captain Bhav, Hausa Bhai Patil and Ganpati Yadav. And by the way, these people are from very different castes. They're very, very different caste groups. The translations of in five Indian languages will be through by June.
Yeah. Yeah. So give the gentleman the mic.
Yeah,
no,
please.
No, no, the time is going to be up.
We got 10 minutes late. We got the hall 10 minutes late. I'm sorry, Mr.
Just 1 minute
no,
left.
Just,
yeah.
Let's finish with that.
Couple of more questions, please. Sir, we got very late.
So this
Mr.
is
Garland.
This is about young people today.
Yeah.
What is the vision for them? What is next for them? Next 50 years, how do you see, you know, these young people playing a different role so that we have a different India?
Yeah. Okay, I love the fact that all of you are asking me contemporary questions because this is a very contemporary book. It's about India today. And this, now, thank you for that. Now, one thing I wanted to say, I think several young people and not an entire generation, I have been teaching 37 years. I find the default mode of youth is idealism. Yeah. What kind of role models do we give them? We gave them Vijay Mallya, Ketan Parikh, Harshad Mehta, and a whole heap of, you know, homicidal buffoons. Yeah, these are the kind of role models we give them. What do we expect? So the question, and the last thing about the history and the robbing of it. You know, there's a beautiful Swahili saying. I love it on history, on how history is written by the victors. It says, if lions were historians, the tales of the jungle would not always favor the hunter.
Thank you, Sainath.
And I'm going to say, reclaim your history. Young people, go back to your homes, talk to your grandparents, talk to your great-grandparents, find your story, your family story, reclaim your history. Thank you.
And a tour. And we could do a tour of these 13 heroes.
P. Sainath, Kavita Srivastava, for this lovely session. I'm sorry, we have to, but look at the time. He will be outside. You can have a conversation with him. With this, we end the session here. Thank you so much for being here.
There it is.